Well, welcome everybody, and thanks for coming to our Let's Collaborate event. I'd like to get us started. I'm going to introduce our today's moderator, who is Lenny Tadelman. Did I pronounce that correctly? He is the co-founder of Protocols.io, which is an open access scientific protocol site. And he will be our moderator today, and he's going to keep us all on time, all in good fun.
And we just get started? As I open the first talk, two quick disclaimers. First one is, I am not a jerk, but I will be in terms of timing. I really do apologize, but we have a lot of speakers, and if you're going over time, I'm going to be so don't do it, and don't wake up in me. The second thing is, very quickly, I really deserve no credit for this year's event. I did help to organize last year's. Here I am simply getting credit for stuff I didn't do. And there is a lot of work that has gone into it that I really can't take credit for. And we've mentioned some of the people, but can we just get the people who spend the last month or two organizing it to get up and give them round of applause, and it's not me. So, there's more people who are sponsoring and organizing. All right, and without further ado, to stay on time, we'll start with the first talk from Daniel.
And I'm not introducing speakers, even though I know most of them, for brevity.
Thank you for that kind introduction. So I'm Daniel Himmelstein, a PhD candidate here at UCSF. And this is how I think of scientific communication currently. I call it Brehm's allegory of academia, where scientists are too busy struggling under an inefficient system to take a break and look at what's wrong and get great gains in efficiency. So what's the situation? What's the problem now? First of all, peer review is often counterproductive because it happens too late. It happens once you've already finished your project and not when you're designing it, when that advice would actually be helpful. Second of all, it's too rigid. You can't communicate back and forth with the reviewers, so it's not effective. And incentives are missing. Reviewers don't have good incentives to do a good job because oftentimes their identities aren't even public and they're not getting rewarded. Next, the process of what goes on to make your study or make your paper is invisible, it's lost, it's not publicized or documented. This means that mistakes are repeated, efforts are duplicated with yourself and between labs, and that science in general is irreproducible. And finally, attribution is ineffective. It's really hard to know who did what and therefore how to reward them. So for example, that's why people are so focused on impact factors, because there's not other good ways, or there aren't very many good ways yet of seeing other factors of what people did and their contributions. So, at the event last year, I met the founder of ThinkLab and started a radically different way of doing science, which is open, online, in real time. So I posted my proposal from the day I created it, and then recruited people from the community to have discussions with and give me advice on how to improve my project and to help me analyze and interpret my results. And not only that, we got some pilot funding, so the people who contribute, they're rated by the community and actually get paid for their efforts. So we call it massively collaborative open science. We've had 22 reviewers, over 53 discussions, and just in this short time had 293 comments. Here you can see actually two of the people, Antoine and Mackenzie, are in attendance. But what I'd like to point out is the great diversity of people, all the different institutions we've brought together on one multi-disciplinary project. So here are my reflections. That doing science openly and in real time like this has allowed me to assemble a high quality network of open scientists. It's made me think before I do something, because I have to justify it in writing, and I also have the organization of everything I did and why I did it. leading to better efficiency and accelerated impact. So here's my public contributions on GitHub, and you can see very clearly when I started doing ThinkLab. I started making way more public contributions. And along with that came much better recognition and brand development personally. And the founder, Jesse Spaulding's in attendance, raise your hand so you can speak to him if you're interested in putting projects up there. The project that I'm working on is creating a network for drug repurposing. It looks like this out of bird's eye view. It's big, has 50,000 types of nodes. I mean, 50,000 nodes of 10 different types and 3 million edges. These come from 28 different public resources. And because we're into open science, we want to release the network so other people can use it, and we want to make the analysis reproducible, so that means releasing the data along every stage of the analysis. But there's a problem. Right now, there are a lot of restrictions on how you can use data. The first is copyright, which is automatically granted to original works of authorship, giving exclusive rights. And an additional restriction is a contract. So some resources require you to enter into a contract to even get access to the resource. And so specifically, we face these complications. We had 9 resources that didn't post any license, which means all rights are reserved. You cannot copy or redistribute it, and contacting them has not been effective. We also face unclear licenses, where we would have to email them and get clarification, which was laborious and slow. Next, we had some licenses that forbid redistribution. So for example, MSigDB, a publicly funded project the Broad Institute put on a very restrictive license. Another big issue is reusing data from publication supplements, which actually the authors have signed copyright transfer agreements with the journals. And this is an issue I'd like to expose in the coming months. And I will skip to my last slide. That after a 5,000-word discussion and much effort, we found a solution. And for you to break these chains, I recommend releasing your data as CC0 into the public domain. So look that up.
Thank you, Daniel. And now a kind introduction for speaker number 2, who is Stephanie Johnson.
About collaboration and what scientists all really want, some citations for their work. I'm from Science Open, the CEO, based in Berlin, originally from California, so I'm back home for Open Access Week. So why did we want to talk about citations? Really, citations expose the collaborations that go into scholarly research in every single paper. Maybe you didn't work directly with these people, but these are these are the people who you're building upon their work. So they are part of the idea that you've put down. And every literature list is basically a genealogy of an idea. And that's one thing that you can understand about a paper when you start looking at the list of citations. So being cited is not just a measure of scientific attention, but it really is fundamental to what we're doing. It really is fundamental to what you care about. And so I think we should really treat it a little bit differently. And at Science Open, this is what we are trying to do. We put on our platform, we're an open platform for scholarly research. We have about 10 million articles and article records on our platform for people to discuss, do post-publication peer review, put into their own curated collections. And on our platform, at the center, is always the article. That's the starting point of everywhere, of our platform. And we really look at the article as then part of a network, as part of a collaborative network that you scientists have built up. And with Science Open, we wanted to start exposing this connectivity and created basically a citation network on our platform. So we are really a freely accessible network for aggregating, sharing, and evaluating scientific research. And we now, like I said, have over 10 million articles that you can search and sort by citation numbers. And you can look at a paper, look at its reference list, sort those by citation numbers, follow a trail of connectivity on our platform. So what we want to offer you as scientists is exactly this. We expose the context of your paper. And we would like to get your work also show the connectivity between your paper and somebody else's through related articles, related collections, related co-authors, etc. So we do this via discovery tools on every article page. So you can check us out and see what you can find. As far as we have reader counts, altmetric scores, citation numbers, related articles, cited by information. So really looking at every single article, how is it connected to the greater body of research? Here's an example of some of the article metrics that we show on each individual paper. And what we want to do on top of that also, to put this back into the scientific realm, is to say, scientists, you can also add context on Science Open. So you can do post-publication peer review on an article, whatever article you can find, so of 10 million. You can add them to a collection, create your own journal. So here's an example of an open post-publication peer review on the platform. It's pretty straightforward, always with your own name. We think that scientific communication should be completely transparent and open. And here's an example of researcher-driven collections, so you can put articles from all over, from every publisher into your collection and say, these are the best articles, these are the articles that I care about, these are the articles that you should care about as well. So this is what we offer on Science Open for scientists. Here you can both explore the connectivity of your own work to others. You can find new papers that are interesting for you. You can add context, join the discussion, and start collaborating with your colleagues. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Is the microphone working for the recording? Is it on? Excellent. And our next speaker is UCSF's Rich Schneider. This works. I'm not sure if this is on. It was on.
How about that? It's good?
Sorry. Okay,
thanks.
No, that's my fault.
Okay. Thanks so much for having me participate in these events every year. And this year I'm going to talk about something different than I've talked about in the past. In the past I've been very much focused on open access and institutional open access policies and repositories. And now I've turned my attention quite a bit towards, I think, the last frontier in open access, which is trying to capture all of the content that is hidden during a process of scholarly communication, which we all know to be called peer review. So I'm sure you all heard one way or another that peer review more or less began about 350 years ago with the first formal journal, the Philosophical Transactions of the Royal Society. And in this early effort to organize scientific thought into a journal, we have the establishment of some important principles about scientific priority, what work is important, and we set forward this idea of peer review. And so peer review has obviously become an important part of the scholarly communication process and the scholarly publication process. It hasn't really changed much in 350 years, and most of the conventions that we have in peer review came about in the 1950s. And there's so much written about problems with peer review, and we could spend all day just talking about peer review and the problems and have heated debates. But as we all know, peer review It can be tediously slow, petty, unfair, biased, it lacks transparency, accountability, recognition. Generally relies on the experts of a couple people, two or three people, which may or may not be well matched to read the article that they're evaluating based on, you know, who's out of town on vacation and the availability of all kinds of reviewers. We all know that it can erroneously reject scientifically valid papers and erroneously accept scientifically flawed papers. And, you know, from a faculty member's point of view, we know that the whole system survives on the backs of free laboring researchers, peer reviewers, and editors who are often very busy, don't have a precise subject matter expertise, and have their own agendas and their own priorities. The piece that I want to focus on is this tremendous amount of intellectual capital and investment that goes unaccounted for and uncaptured during the peer review process. We know that typical reviewers spend about 5 hours per review, around 8 articles a year. I think that number is low for many people. And these are data from SCM Report 2009. There are about 1.8 to 1.9 million peer-reviewed articles published every year. So if you do the math on that, it's about 5 million peer reviews if each paper was reviewed only once. And all of us know that, you know, to get a paper peer reviewed only once in one journal is an unlikely event. So you can do the math on that and know that there are a lot of peer reviews out there, and they contain some very useful information. We did a calculation back in 2013 that UC authors or UC faculty, academic senate faculty, contribute about $21 million based on FTEs and time and numbers of peer reviews back to the publishing system that they never recoup. But again, the other part of this is that there are valuable evaluative information about all the published articles that's rarely available to researchers, to students, or to the public, and there would be a great public benefit and a great benefit to the research enterprise, I think, if that content was available. So I'd like just to put forward this idea of open peer review. There's a lot of people talking about this. There are many efforts in many different ways that people are approaching this, and we've heard a little bit about that already today. But really, you can think about open peer review. You can break it down into pre-publication peer review and think about how transparency in the pre-publication peer review process would generate accountability, assign credit for that work, promote fairness in the peer review process, expose conflicts of interest, and capture valuable intellectual assets and contributions that faculty make. There are many systems for post-publication peer review. We've heard about Science Open and others. This enables greater participation of people who really are subject matter experts, creates dialogue between authors and readers, accelerates the rate of discovery, enhances reproducibility, and reduces, maybe even eliminates, retractions, builds communities, facilitates collaborations, and makes publication a dynamic versus a static process. And so, we've got many of the thought leaders in this movement here today in the room. There are many others that are trying pre-publication peer review models, others that are focusing on the peer reviews themselves, and others that are working hard to create post-publication peer review environments. And I just want to point everyone's attention to public comments if you haven't seen it. These are some examples I pulled off from today, where people, if they publish in PubMed, they can participate in the commenting feature. Here's the first one, an interesting paper, but coordinates provided in table one are not MNI space, they're likely MM coordinates, which also provides, also provided by the analytics software. Can the authors provide a correct coordinates and perhaps as an errata? So you can kind of see how a dialogue gets established, and with that, you can appreciate that there's tremendous value in bringing a larger community and associating that with the papers. So thank you for your time.
Most people who would like to hear these things are not in this room. So if you have a Twitter account, occasionally do tweet in the interest of openness. All right, and kind introduction for speaker number four.
Okay. Hi everyone, so it's a delight to be here. I'm here to tell you about Wikipedia, something you all know about, but hopefully you'll learn something new about some of the collaborations Wikipedia makes with other communities. So way back in the ancient light years ago of January 2014, there's a study that suggests that we all go to Wikipedia first now ahead of any other source of healthcare information. And that's true for both all of us as health professionals and the general public. And I don't know if you knew this, but the top 100 English Wikipedia pages for healthcare topics were averaged 1.9 million times during 2013. If we talk about sort of clinicians, physicians, healthcare providers using Wikipedia, There's a number of studies that have been done that basically prove what we all kind of surmise, which is that we use Wikipedia too. Even though we're health professionals, we go there. In fact, we go there first, it turns out. This study of 94% of med students is actually pretty dated. I guarantee it's got to be 100% of my UCSF med students. So I'd like to publicly declare that we no longer need to be ashamed about it. Let's own up to it. We all use Wikipedia. Amen, brothers and sisters. Okay? So, let's look at the literature for scientists too, from the Journal of Medical Internet Research. A colleague of mine, James Heilman, I should point out that was him in the corner there, his slides. That one. So he published this journal. First of all, I want to point out that you don't like the citation thing's interesting, but here's a new term if you're not familiar with it. Tweetations. It's how many people cite your article in tweets. So that's a pretty early figure when this was published, so I'm sure the numbers are much higher now. In any case, James and colleagues from the abstract, Wikipedia's medical content at the end of 2013, 155,000 articles, 1 billion bytes of text, 255 languages. And supported by more than 950,000 references. That content was viewed 4.88 billion times in that 1 year, 4.88 billion. I'm not sure if you knew this, but did you know that all Wikipedia articles are graded for quality? Here's the grading scale. It turns out it's all Wikipedia articles, but I'm just showing you the health-related articles. All articles start as a stub, and they work their way up the scale if people add more information, all the way up that scale. You can see the grading rubric here. It's a superficial, but you could click on the show icons and get more detail about what it takes to move up the quality scale in Wikipedia and be deemed more rigorous. Anybody heard of Wiki Project Medicine here? Show of hands. Fantastic. Those of you that didn't raise your hands, here's the new part. Wiki Project Medicine is an all-volunteer corps of about 250 people only who are committed to improving the quality of health-related content on Wikipedia. You all can be part of Wiki Project Medicine today if you want to, because they have taken all the roughly 26,000 English language Wikipedia health-related topics and rank ordered them by importance. And what I think is really awesome about this rank ordering is that they've included both global burden of disease and number of eyeballs clicking on the pages. So human sexuality, really important. A lot of people read about it on Wikipedia. So too is Ebola. So too is dengue fever, even though dengue fever is not a really big problem here in the US. James and colleagues actually have some pictures I want to show you from their article, which I also think is really awesome. We know this. Most of the internet's in English. We also know that most of the world doesn't speak English. And if you look at the internet by language as compared with Wikipedia by language, Wikipedia is the most multilingual part of the internet. Why? Because everybody can contribute. It's not the world's distribution of language spoken, but it's closer. So James says, if we want to get high-quality medical information to the world's population in the language of their preference, Wikipedia is probably the most viable strategy to do so. Anybody heard of Wikipedia Zero? Show of hands. Rock on, there's even more people that are going to learn stuff. Only the two Wikipedians in the room have heard about Wikipedia Zero. I'm here to tell you about it. Okay, it's a really kick-ass opportunity to provide access to Wikipedia to the world's population in the developing country for free. On their cell phones, because they access Wikipedia on their cell phones just like we do, but cell phone carriers charge a buttload of money for data access charges. Wikipedia says, hey, we're a free encyclopedia. Cell phone provider, give access for free. And cell phone providers are stepping up and doing it. So right now, more than 400 million people in the world in 69 mobile phone carriers in 61 developing countries have access to Wikipedia for free. There's the wiki page on Wikipedia Zero, and you can see some of the countries that are participating. Anybody heard of Translators Without Borders? Rock on, only one person. Fabulous, you're learning something new today. Translators Without Borders, a humanitarian organization that translates for social good. They've translated 27 million words, and they collaborate with all the other people I mentioned to translate Wiki Project Medicine articles into more than 100 languages. Anybody heard of Wiki Edu? Okay, fantastic. It's the bridge between academia and Wikipedia, a foundation based here in the city to provide us help for how to provide high-quality information to the world's population. So everybody, all those are collaborators, and the people missing, I'll end it here. Who's missing from this partnership? Step up, everyone. It's us. Let's get on board and collaborate.
remind me, how did I get stuck with being the asshole who has to cut off brilliant talks?
Hello, I'm Lauren Bianchini, and I want to talk about how I, as a researcher, as a young researcher, as a student, can make my research more visible. And I'm going to summarize it in 7 tips. And just to present myself, I'm the COO of My Science Work, and we provide Polaris, and it's a product to help research labs and institutions to make their research more visible. So we've given it a bit of a thought. So now we're going to focus on how you can do it easily. But first, why? Why communicate about research and share it? Well, two obvious answers. On the academic side, well, to improve the discoverability of your work. That means, well, increase citations because people don't cite work that they don't know exist. But also to make yourself more visible, just to increase more opportunities, job opportunities, collaborations, fundings, projects, well, all kind of stuff. And on the other side, a more even more obvious is the impact on society. Sharing your research, communicating your research, you know about it, but it educates people and also improves access to research and knowledge for the greater good of our society, so just let's do it. And I've come up with 7 tips to easily, I called it 7 tips for ethical growth hacking of scientific visibility. And what I want you to think after the end of my talk is that it's easy. So first, share your joy. Yeah, it's a science, it's a nature. So that paper, maybe you've worked on it more than 9 months, right? So just talk about it around you, get excited, and email it to people, whatever, just talk about it. Two, ask for feedback and advice. Well, feedback will always improve your research and your papers, but it also raises awareness of what you do and then sparks interest and curiosity about you and about your next work. How wonderful. Three, share everything that's shareable. So preprints, presentations, but whatever you have worked on that you feel like you could share and that people will be happy to use and will be happy to refer to. That will help people discover your work and know about what you're doing, but also it allows you to claim ownership soon in the research process. Four, discuss and be active. I know you know it, but it starts from around the coffee machine and goes everywhere where you go and you interacts with people, even on Facebook. And that helps you build an expertise and show your expertise, but also connect with peers. You will learn by discussing with people, and you can also get to test your ideas. Five, disseminate. That slide is a bit big, but I've put here the traditional good academic practices. You do all of them. Go to conferences, do posters, email, publish in prestigious journals, institutional repositories. Don't forget that one. Your university is providing you with a great tool to share your research, so use it. And then all that stuff can go on the web. So general social media, we don't need to talk about. Scientific social media, first is us, My Science Work, then ResearchGate, academia.edu, Mendeley, and then also other tools. I've put About Me, that's the easiest way for me, I think, to put a CV online, but also Medium is the easiest way to get a blog and get readers. Well, choose your favorite one, don't try to be active on all of them. It will use your individual network, not just to share holiday pigs and cats, but also to talk about what you really care about and what you do, and just increases the number of people who really know what you do. Six, a popular science and PR. Your university has a PR department. Do they know what you do? Well, if they don't, maybe it would be interesting to connect with them, to share with them your success stories, and to say how excited you are about your projects. You can also yourself write articles, short articles for the general public, And that in general will also help yourself better understand the impact of your research, develop writing skills, and produce non-academic content to be put out in the web. Seven and last, share lists of links. People will be grateful if you do that. So if you can pick a subject where you read a lot of articles, and then you share this in a comprehensive, easy to access way, well, people will really appreciate. And that was it. So that was the seven tips that I choose to easily make your research available, but I'd be very happy to hear about your thoughts about that and your tips in the discussion part that will take part after the presentations. Thank you.
William is the most prolific person tweeting this event. It's good that he's up here because we might want to hold off on tweeting his talk until we know the answer to the title.
Oh, no, please, don't hold back.
I was joking.
You know, if you want to ignore my talk and go sign up for an ORCID, that's totally cool with me. Yeah, go ahead and do that right now. If you don't have an ORCID, it's like a DOI, but for you as a researcher, it'll really help you out more than anything I can possibly say. Okay, so there is this theory out there. Let me say first, you know, we've heard some really, really interesting things from lots of people who are doing really cool stuff. I'm going to be talking about some existing research a little bit. This theory that one of the benefits of open access is your work gets out there, it gets read more, it gets cited more. In order for that to be true, two things kind of have to happen. Well, yes, the open access papers need to be read more, and the papers that are read more need to be cited more. So, you know, to give you the bullet points up front, yes, they are read more. Not totally sure about the citations. In some cases, yes. In some cases, no. And I'll tell you a little bit about some of that detail. So here's the money slide here. A lot of research has looked at the effect of the differences between the way open access articles and non-open access articles are cited. Many of them have found that you have an increased likelihood to be cited if you pick an open access article at random, kind of looking at it from an epidemiological standpoint, your relative risk of being cited is higher. That's the actual framework they used. There's another one who did this controlled trial where he went to a publisher that was a closed access publisher, randomly made some of their articles with their permission open access, and then looked at it afterwards, which was kind of artificial when they came up with, you know, results that don't necessarily mean anything. But he did find that, those papers were downloaded and read almost twice as much. And this has also been shown, so this is in health, it's also been shown in legal scholarship and in economics. So there's pretty good evidence that, you know, if for no other reason, you should publish your work open access just for the selfish personal reason that, you know, it gets your name out there more. You know, you can have more bragging rights. So that said, citations are not the only thing that matter when it comes to, you know, looking at your scholarship. You have a much greater impact on the world at large by the research that you do than just on the people who are reading and citing your papers. Ideally, your work is going to have an impact outside of academia, you know, and I think most of you are probably hoping that would be the case. It's not just, you know, other people reading it are also in your little, you know, field of science. Funding agencies, it happens more of that too. All of the major U.S. funding agencies have public access policies. Private funders are following suit. You need to understand this because they're going to start asking you, and if you tell them, this is how I'm getting broader impact for the grant money I'm asking you to give me, that's getting to be an argument that the funders are really more receptive to listening to. So I come from Mendeley. I thought I would take a look at this and see, is there any relationship on our platform between, you know, downloads and readers and all this kind of stuff? It turns out that there is a little bit of a relationship. But there's a whole lot of people that are downloading things, or maybe they're not people, maybe they're, you know, bots or, you know, text, you know, mining things or whatever, that are not coming up as readers. So there's an interesting things going on there. Curiously enough, if you just look at PLOS and you look at their downloads where they filter out some of the bot counts, you see a better correlation. So sort of supporting that that theory. But broader picture. So we talked a little bit about citations. There's also all of these other things over here, like ratings on F1000, comments on PLOS. PubMed Commons wasn't around when this study was done. And you can see that the activity on each of these things most looks like itself. So citation-like activity correlates. So the darker the square here is, the higher the correlation of each measurement is to the other measurement. Okay, that's the what this is showing you. And you can see citations most look like citations. Social activity kind of really only looks like itself, but it kind of looks like some other social activity. And then there's this middle thing with downloads, Mendeley saves, site-like, that kind of looks where they kind of look like themselves a little bit. So this is like these things here, they're calling scholarly sharing. And so it's a citation-like behavior. So all of those things are important for understanding the impact that publishing open access has on your work.
And we have predatory publishers are something that we all hate. Possibly the only thing I hate more than them is the person who curates the predatory publishing list. So it's wonderful to have not him present on this.
This is such an important topic, it takes two of us. Publisher perish, avoiding predatory publishers and conferences. I will say, a lot of the talks so far have been about open peer review, new concepts, Wikipedia editing. I think this talk is a little more about everyday science today and how not to get caught in the trap of publishing in journals where you don't want to be. So this very brief, we all know this concept, but publisher perish, publications in peer-reviewed journals, peer review as currently practiced with all of its flaws, remains coin of the realm for academic advancement, and that's why we have the phrase publish or perish. So, if you're in this, open access publishing, this audience knows it very well, but just a brief recap, if you do encounter anybody in your sphere who's still not sold on OA, it's more accessible to other researchers as well as the general public, certainly for readership, and as we just heard, sometimes for citation, sometimes not, still being studied. Many reputable open access publishers exist, so you don't have to in any way go with a non-reputable publisher such as PLOS, Biomed Central, or Hindawi. The funding model for open access, generally speaking, is author pays or funder pays. There's no subscription fees for open access journals, so that's how they're generally funded. That's fully compatible with peer review. However, it does invite abuse from quote-unquote publishers who seek such fees, but they do not actually publish a legitimate journal. Those are the predatory publishers. So given that, it may seem obvious, but they're worth bear repeating because there's so much pressure to publish, as we all know. If you get one of these inquiries, do your colleagues know the journal? Have you ever heard of it? Can you easily identify and contact the publisher, meaning they would have a street address? Is the journal clear about the type of peer review it uses? Do you recognize anyone on the editorial board? Are the articles indexed in places such as PubMed? Is it clear what fees they will charge and what it'll be used for? And is the publisher a member of a recognized industry group? And we're pulling a lot of these. There's this problem with predatory journals is so pervasive that there's a new initiative called Think, Check, Submit, which we invite you all to check out. And a lot of those tips come from there. I'll turn it over to Annalisa with respect to conferences, which are similar problems.
So along the lines of evaluating publishers, you may in the audience have been solicited by publishers or organizations to submit to their journals or to their conferences, and it may just be a complete unknown to you. This is one of the things that open access, a lot of the what's called predatory open access publishers are known for doing. So for conferences, they, you know, in addition to doing journals, a lot of these groups will also put on conferences that sometimes sort of dupe people. So just looking again, sort of stating the obvious, if they're, do they provide contact information? Who is the organizer? Are they people that you recognize? Are the people who are presenting there people that you recognize? And do they actually state the conference purpose? It's the same thing, like if you go to look at a journal page that you're not familiar with, a lot of times these you know, not very reputable publishers will have a very vague and very just sort of broad statement about what their purpose is. If it's something that doesn't really resonate or doesn't seem like very meaningful, then you know, look further or pass. And also, are they charging fees? There, we've heard stories of conferences charging fees not only just to register but also to be a presenter. And are they upfront about that? Anything that's a reputable source is going to be very upfront about what they're providing, what they're charging. So Mark has mentioned the Think Check Submit page. We also have a web page on the library website, and we actually developed this. We have some very similar kinds of sources that we list. We developed this in conjunction with our a library committee, a faculty committee, the Committee on Library and Scholarly Communication. And I invite you to check out that page and use the resources there. There's, in addition to these lists that are sort of these common sense things to check, there's approaches such as creating a white list of publishers or organizations that have been reviewed. There's a source called Quality Open Access Market, where scholars can go in and create a journal scorecard for a particular publisher, and you know, multiple renditions can be done for each publication. And then there's the blacklist approach, which is what Lenny referred to, which is the listing of predatory journals. There is a source called Beale's List, and we have a link to that from this URL. And the person who creates this list is somewhat controversial, just because he's a known open access opponent.
An open access antagonist.
Antagonist, exactly. However, he really does a valuable job in evaluating the publishers.
The list is good.
Yeah, the list, the work that he does really is good, but just sort of, it's taken along with all the other information, along with your own judgment about the resources. And if you have any questions, feel free to refer to the library, and we can always help you in investigating someone that you're not quite sure about.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Let me just open that. Yeah, we would go to the website.
That's the right way.
It's ICIS.UCLA.edu. Hi, everybody. I don't have any slides. Just a few talking points and a web page that should be displayed in a moment.
It's ICIS, right?
ICIS. Other ICIS. Poorly named, but too late to
change. You named it before, though.
We did, yes. We were first. So, my name is Mackenzie Smith, and I run a big research library at UC Davis. And I'm a longtime open access advocate, but I'm also a senior university administrator. So what I've seen over the last 10 years is that our valiant attempts to achieve broad, scalable open access for publications is struggling, right? Because, well, there are lots of reasons. One is that the current system of scholarly communication is unsustainable financially, and our attempts to fix that aren't actually helping with that problem. But I think the more serious issue is that publications have become a proxy for quality and impact, right? So every university is struggling to maintain its rankings, increase its rankings, increase its research funding. This trickles down all the way through the ranks. So every academic is under enormous pressure to demonstrate impact. And sadly, that means impact factor, right? We are trying to change that system, but it is incredibly hard and slow. So we're not going to give up. But in the meantime, I keep thinking about how scholarship is changing, and the new forms of scholarship aren't broken yet, right? So I'm talking about things like websites and blogs and Twitter feeds, and importantly, things like data and software. How many people in this room, in their research, have some connection with either a data or software that you write or use? Yep. And how many of you have even thought for a moment that you need to treat that equivalently to a publication and give credit for using it and should get credit for having contributed to it? You know, it's kind of a foreign concept, even though we're all doing this. We're using software, we're creating software. So I think We need to focus on the things that we can fix quickly to demonstrate success and start to get these entrenched systems of credit for academic work out of the mindset that only publications count. Okay, so we have a project at Davis called Innovating Communication and Scholarship that's looking at how scholarly work is changing. And, you know, of course, we look at open access things, but we also look at other kinds of publications, and I, in particular, am focusing on things like data and software. So one of the things we've noticed is that when you produce software, people who actually are getting credit for it are doing so because they've published a paper, and people cite the paper. And I'm looking at John here, because the same thing's happening with data, right? What we're doing is putting new wine in old bottles and taking new forms of scholarship and putting them into the paradigm that we're trying to get rid of. So, and I'm not saying that's a completely bad idea, but it is leading to the problem that we're trying to get credit for software by citing publications that are published by commercial publishers, typically. They're all rushing into this space as quickly as they can, so we're just going to make the problem worse, right? So how do you start to get credit for people in new ways, other than just publishing an article and then citing that and trying to get everybody to do that? Well, that's what this event is about. We're going to be looking at efforts that are going on now, both by publishers and by software companies and others, to come up with new ways to give you credit for the work that you do beyond just citations to publications, and look at the kind of interesting problem of why is it that hiring committees and promotion and tenure committees don't pay attention to this stuff? You know, how are we going to get them to change that behavior? So that's really the focus of the project. And in particular, we've got this one working on geological sciences software. So we're working with scientists who live or die by this software. And the whole community depends on it. There are more than 900 software producers working on the code and thousands of researchers using it. So we figure if we can get it to work in that community, it can work in other communities too. But we're also very interested in hearing from other communities that are also trying to do this. So if any of you are interested in this problem, you should come to this event or at least get in touch with us so we can work with you. And that is it. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Our official time on the Eventbrite page is till 5:30, but that's the space here for conversations, talks, and the Q&A, but obviously we have smorgasbord outside, and we want you to linger, talk, and discuss long after that. So why don't we thank all of the speakers again? The idea now was just to open up the room to discussions, questions to the speakers on stuff they've talked about, or just dialogue about open access, collaboration, the themes that came up, and I don't want to do too much driving, so do we have questions for any of the speakers from the themes that came up? Yep.
I have a question for
Annalise. I'll be passing out the microphone just because we are.
So I have a question about the predatory conferences. I mean, I think we all must get emails 4 or 5 a week from Judy or Crystal, having haven't responded to their last email. And do people actually go to those conferences, and what happens when you get there?
Yeah, so I actually know the answer to what happens, not firsthand, I will let you know, but secondhand, you know, by which I mean I read it on a blog somewhere. But there was a firsthand account of a guy who actually went, and when he got there, he realized that he was, there were like 15 conferences going on, hosted by the same organizer in the same place. So, you know, they had this room, and they had it, you know, subdivided up in these little groups. And essentially what everyone did is they showed up, and they were really, really concerned to get everyone who showed up to take a group photo to kind of prove that you were there, right? And then everyone just pisses off and goes on vacation. The whole point of it, as far as he could tell, was that it's a way to, you know, legitimately spend grant money on vacations. And they're always held in places like Orlando and, you know, things like that. So, you know, that is my best understanding of why it is that something that's just so obviously, like, weird, you know, still is actually being used, is that their people have to be in on it somehow. And that's what you see with predatory publishing, too, over in the Asian countries there. You get credits, you get sometimes cash incentives for publishing in an international journal, and that's why all of the predatory journals will name themselves International Journal of, you know, insert name here. So, I mean, there's definitely some complicit stuff in there.
We've discussed it with you, William. We've actually done an analysis 2 years ago when Buchanan's sting on open access came out. We did an analysis on our readers. We have data that's just like Mendeley. Well, it's much smaller, but what people are reading and saving in from PubMed. Right? So we have users and they have libraries. And what we did is we took a look from that sting, so that we would need to update the analysis. Our users were young. They had 100,000 articles in their libraries at this point. Today we have over a million, so it would be nice to repeat it. I actually want William to do it with Mendeley. But what we did is we answered exactly that question. Does anybody read the scam journals, right? Is it really that much of a problem? And it turns out of the papers, of the journals that rejected the scam paper, right, tons of articles in the libraries of our users from those journals, because people read those journals and they actually sent it out for peer review and realized the paper is crap. Of all the journals that accepted, right, we actually essentially had no articles from those journals in our users' databases. Right? So it was a very clear binary thing. The good journals, people read. The scam journals, they publish. They waste resources and money. But it's not like people are reading bad science, is my takeaway. And I'd love to do the analysis with Mendeley. It's still a problem, and we should still avoid it, of course.
Yes, and by all means, we should continue paying Mr. Beal's speaker fees to come and tell everyone what a big problem it is.
All right. Other comments or questions on the predators?
It's not about predators.
It can be your name.
Thanks. This is a question for the first speaker, and I guess the person that maybe developed the software or runs the organization, said this here as well. But yeah, so it's curious. I mean, it's, you know, a great idea to have this sort of, you know, open, collaborative review and with incentives. And I was curious how those incentives are divvied up. I mean, because you would think that volume is not a great incentive. You would want to sort of go for quality. How do you compensate people that really put time and thought into it and provide the most value to improve the work? So that's one question, and sort of related to that, so I was wondering if there's any thoughts about how this might, so it sounds like you were doing maybe sort of in the development of your studies, getting feedback, but if you're trying to use this to interface with the sort of more traditional peer review practice, whereas now there are some companies where you can sort of pay for peer review and then send those reviews to a journal, that if anyone's trying to sort of say, I'm going to put my $5,000 of grant money up there, secure my own reviews, respond to them, address them, and when I submit to a journal, provide sort of a response to reviewers and say this has been through at least some sort of peer review already.
Josh?
Sure.
Or
Daniel?
You.
With regard to the first question, the comments are peer assessed, so it's basically you kind of indicate the level of value you think that's adding, and that's based on those peer assessments that the financial incentive is distributed. With regard to your second question, that's not something I've thought about a lot. I haven't really thought that far ahead. We don't have any projects that have actually got to this stage of publishing a paper.
Yeah, I don't think the first question is a big problem just because the other readers rate the comments at their perceived value.
the wall with people voting, all voting for each other.
I don't think that will be a problem. I think there's algorithms that can look at that, and we can, I mean, right now it's limited to people that have the email at a research institution, but longer term, there's...
Yeah, longer term, I think there's going to be ways to prevent any kind of circle of, like, you know, giving each other money.
I just wanted to briefly, to the pre-publication, we're doing with Science Open an experiment to say, what if we offer scientists the possibility to find an endorser for their paper, somebody who will give them feedback on the paper, read it, and then sign on the publication that I have read this paper, given the author's feedback, and now think that this paper is of a quality to enter into the scientific literature. So you basically have somebody with their name saying, this is good. And we're trying that out to also sort of speed up this peer review process and make it more a dialogue between scientists without publishers always in the middle. So we're trying that out as another experiment in peer review. Maybe something somebody else might want to also jump in on.
I get free exercise.
just to pick up on that point and make an interesting little tie to Wikipedia. When I was working for the Wikimedia Foundation, talking to professors, trying to do the early stages of designing a program to help connect Wikipedia with academia, one of the comments that we got from a professor I spoke with was that, and he was a journal reviewer. He was a journal editor. So he was really concerned about the peer review process, and he was really frustrated because in the kind of time frame that you had in a graduate program, it was impossible for his students to experience peer review, to experience the kind of conversations that could take place over decades. You know, when one person publishes an article, someone responds to it or incorporates it, and it goes back and forth a few times. And he was really excited because he felt that by engaging with Wikipedia, that potentially gave his students the opportunity to experience that kind of academic dialogue.
So I have a question for Mackenzie at Davis. Are you guys trying at all to work with any existing like altmetric companies like Impact Story or Altmetric to try and get more of that code and things like that into the overall picture of what your scholarship is?
Sure, but the point I was trying to make is that the typical behavior of people is to cite a paper rather than, I mean, there's a big problem about getting people to pay attention to altmetrics, and that's something we're working on. But what I'm just trying to do here is think about how to get you to cite data or software directly rather than authoring a paper and paying to get it published or publishing it in a commercial journal, right? And so I love altmetrics, but you try getting a tenure committee to use them, right? We got a ways to go.
Just also a comment on citing software. Titus Brown recently had a discussion
who's
on...
Who's also at UCD?
Yep, he's now. And by the way, Jonathan Eisen called Mackenzie the most successful poaching by Davis. Davis apparently is very good at poaching. But the comment was Titus Brown recently talked about the fact that journals, subscription journals, right, the high-impact ones, will very often, because they want very small, short articles, well, very often the editors will ask you to remove citations to software just to make the paper shorter and to have fewer references in it. It's insane, right? But that actually happens. It's a huge issue.
And you should, you know, yell and kick up a fuss when that happens and say, no, I'm not going to do that. This probably isn't a good point to mention that it's getting a lot easier to introduce those kinds of citations. the way Mendeley always worked is we had this tool and you can just, you know, press a button and the citation goes into your paper and you don't have to mess with it. So we're doing a similar thing for data. We're generating citations for data and you'll be able to insert those just like you've always done. So hopefully that will make, you know, the process a little bit easier. You're working with some data you want to share with people, you put it up, you know, wherever Mendeley data, wherever you want to, you know, your, you know, institution repository, wherever it's, you know, it, the data needs to be. And you can put software there, yes. Yes. Yep. And so, you know, you're going to, when you do that, not only do you get a citation metadata, so you can plug that citation into your paper and just cite it like you're doing anything else, you know, but you also get another important thing, you get a DOI for that, right, which means that it gets out into Crossref, it gets registered, you get permanent preservation, so long-term preservation of that stuff as an official work of scholarship. So you're getting more of the kind of the infrastructure around these other scholarly objects too. So it's happening.
I have no idea what the order was. You're a speaker, so you already had some of the microphone.
Super quick question. How do you link to software and data? How do you, like, because giving a DOI is great, but the DOI for what? Like, do you have like a do you link to a repository and an open access GitHub hosted repository? I don't know, I'm just asking.
Well, there's a couple of different ways you can do it. So if you upload, if you're using Mendeley data, for example, and you've been uploading data as you're working on it into your private data repository, then you said, okay, this is ready, you know, I'm ready to make this data set available. I've you know, sent in my publication, or this thing's ready for release. You flip the publication switch, and then your article gets, you know, it goes live on the web. It gets permanently backed up. It gets snapshotted, so that particular version is not frozen, you know. And that's when you get that that link. So the link then resolves to that publication page where you've published your data on Mendeley data. You can also have links to go to, you know, Zenodo or Dataverse or, you know, your IR, wherever your data might be. But it's nice to have it in a place that has a long-term preservation policy. And so, I mean, software is data, right? you can treat, you know, the files, right? I don't think you should separate the two. I think if you're going to be storing data in a place, you need to store the software that you use to generate or process that data alongside it and as part of that same package. So I don't think there's a separation.
And sorry, can I just put in a plug really fast? So I'm from the library and we do have a tool here. Thank you.
So I'm the data management librarian at here at UCSF, and we actually do have a tool called DataShare, which is basically an open data repository. So if you put, if you're looking for a place to share your data, you can put it in DataShare and you'll get that DOI so you can cite it. So we're excited if anyone wants to use it. Ask us any questions about it.
All right, thanks. And then Daniel. Sorry, Daniel. No worries.
Hi, my question is for the librarians, and it's not directly related to your presentations, but it has to do with, in general, open access publishing funds. And it seems like you have a classic problem where libraries can't repurpose subscription budgets for APCs until the publishers switch over their journals to open access journals, but then the publishers can't switch over the journals from subscriptions to open access until the library switch the subscriptions to APCs. So it's this classic problem, and it's like, who's going to go first? And so no one's really going, or it's happening very slowly. And I'm curious, it seems to me that one way of solving this problem is by, you know, large scale collaboration. And I'm curious if there's any kinds of projects going on, or if you have any sort of thoughts on how to get around this kind of cat and mouse game or chicken and egg problem.
I'm sure Emily will have something to say too, but you're absolutely right. We're in this situation today where we're paying three times for the same article. It's we still have to subscribe, we're archiving it green, and we're supporting OA fees, often for the same journal that we subscribe to, right? Because so many of these hybrid journals are coming out. But I do think that there is a possibility that we could flip the system to a sustainable gold model in our lifetime. And we have a project that all the campuses are involved in called Pay It Forward, where we're looking to see what that would look like financially. Okay, so it's building some financial models to say at what price across different disciplines could we flip it today and go 100%. So I think we're getting to the point where we have to start asking those questions, because we can't keep paying for it three times. You know, I can do that for a little while, but it's going to start hurting. Well, it already hurts. So I want to ask that question and be rigorous about it, really, and see if we can figure out how to get out of this situation.
Yeah, and I would just add to that that, you know, right now the payment for article processing charges for open access, so, you know, gold open access, is being paid for from many different sources, you know, compared to like the traditional model of subscriptions, where it's, you know, typically a library is paying, has like one lump collections budget, pays for that. Right now APCs are being paid mostly by individual researchers out of grant funding, and perhaps their departments are paying for it, but I think in most cases it's grant funding. And some individuals are paying out of pocket, believe it or not, because those APCs can be quite high. We do have a fund, that, like in the case at UCSF, we do have an open access publishing fund. Right now it's being funded by funds from the Academic Senate, which is a faculty body, but it's really just a drop in the bucket of the number of articles that it can fund compared to what gets published at UCSF. So this is definitely an issue, and we've questioned whether the value of continuing that fund just because of that, because it's so few articles. I mean, UCSF authors and co-authors publish 6,000 articles per year. I mean, we're a very, very prolific institution as far as publishing, and the OA fund is going to publish maybe like 20 to 30 at UCSF articles per year. So it's a very small percentage of what's actually being published out there.
I'm not a librarian, but I could add that there are some examples of collaborations. In High Energy Physics does one, I think it's called Scope 3. And any other examples of this kind of thing?
Open Library Humanities is trying to do this?
Yeah, for books. Yeah. So there are a lot of different people trying a lot of different models to get around it.
It's on the same theme, which is essentially the, you know, how do we try and take some of the money back? The publishers are, you know, well aware they're double, triple dipping, they're you know, making a killing here, and they recognize it. They're so excited. So, and we've talked, you know, we talked to the library committee faculty about at certain points just saying no and not getting into the subscription increases. But are we also, we have talked about it for a while, but I don't know what we're doing, of those 6,000 articles, how many of them are gold OA? And are we going back to the publishers and saying, we spent as an institution, regardless of the source, this amount of money, we want that discounted off of our licensing agreement?
Yeah,
I'm trying to.
So in the UK, where, you know, in this country, green is much more popular, but in the UK, where gold has been around for a while, they're starting to do these offsetting negotiations where you say, okay, we published 1,000 open access articles, so we want a discount on our license. And some publishers are going along with that, not Elsevier, but some of the others.
They publicly say they are.
Well, they're not, but some of the others are. So that might be a transitional model so that we don't go broke during the transition. But that's a pretty new thing, just in the past 6 months or so. But it is a positive sign.
So you got a comment. I'll get to Neil in a second, but there was a comment. It's still on this trend. Did you have a comment for Liz?
On this one. Yeah.
Okay. And then Daniel, and then you, because there's no queue.
Yeah, so I'm from UC Press, and just first one plug and then an answer. So we try and do different things to change the status quo. We launch an open access journal, Collabra, where we give credit, monetary value back to reviewers, and reviewers can actually keep that money or pay forward to their institutions. But I think the problems that we're running into is also it's not really, I think, up to the publishers and the libraries to figure this one out, right? I mean, a lot of this has to do with tenure and promotion, and a lot of it has to do with the choices that researchers make when they decide to publish and where. That's the foundation that we need to change. I think if we can change that, then publishers will follow. We will follow for sure, right? But it's not just us in the library that have to figure it out.
So I just wanted to say a lot can be accomplished in open science by just saying no. And then actually you have to say no a lot. So some examples are the editor that wanted you to take out the citations. Or now Spark made an addendum which you can attach your copyright transfer agreements to a journal, which basically says, no, we're going to retain non-exclusive rights and therefore we can share our own paper. Or another example would be collaborators. Just say, no, I'm not publishing in a subscription journal. And then finally, the biggest one, which I'm currently tackling as we speak, is universities want you to sign agreements to get jobs which actually can prevent you from publishing your work openly, because they have the ownership of the work and could potentially suppress it. So I'm trying to say no to this, and I'll report back how it goes. Thanks, Mackenzie.
Hi, I'm Alexandra. I've been kind of listening and trying to figure out from a higher level perspective or just a left field perspective, what is the biggest blocker to open publication? And from what I've heard, not being in this field, it seems like underlying it all is a kind of deep human emotions of fear and shame, which a couple of people kind of touched on, which needs maybe to be. It seems like there's the movement and the tool providers here could benefit from maybe reassuring people, and there's an education piece probably that, you know, you'll still be loved and successful if you publish openly, or better yet, you'll be more loved and more successful, right? And I think the movement will have succeeded when it stops becoming a thing, and you don't have to be proud to be open access, it's just normal and mainstream.
Can I just abuse my privilege as moderator in the last minute to close it on this exact theme with what I actually wanted to open it with, which was what I wanted to say in the introduction is that open access is the movement, it's about 20 years, right, of hard work from a lot of people. And what it has accomplished in those 20 years is absolutely remarkable, right? We've gone from 0% of papers being open access back in 95, and probably even in 2002, right? PLOS Biology launched in 2003, so we are, somebody give me a better number, but I think we're at about 25-30%, not that high yet.
But it's much higher than
what? Right, so it's much higher, but the problem is, and this is what came up here, the problem is, the progress has been remarkable. The problem is, what hasn't happened is we're not 100% away. And what that means is, the libraries are still paying all of the subscriptions that they were paying before, and now we're also paying for publication of open access, right? And it's, we have to get to that 100%, which is hard to do, but I think there are a lot of the collaborative stuff, the peer review, opening up peer review and the post-publication peer review, I think is a huge thing. We didn't have enough time to discuss that in detail, but I think that's one of the key things in moving away from assessing based on journals. And the last thing that I just, it's not really part of the theme, but I think it's a new and important player in this, we didn't bring it up, is preprints. And I wrote a blog post on this yesterday talking about, because there's a huge fear of going open access exclusively, committing to it, and will it hurt my career, right? There are some people here like me from the Eisen Lab who've made that commitment, but not everyone can do that, and not in all labs will it make no difference. But preprints are something that everybody can and should be doing. And if we get to a point where 100% of everything we're publishing is also on the preprint server, like archive or bioarchive, libraries are going to have a pretty compelling case to go to the publisher and say, we're not going to pay for this anymore because there's a free version of everything available. So it's a new thing that's really 1 or 2 years in biomedicine and physics, of course, it's how you publish.
Thank you.
logic of that argument, right, is that if everything is available as a preprint, we can stop subscribing to the journals, in which case they'll all fail, right?
Mm-hmm.
So there won't be any journals to submit your articles to. The preprints don't, you know, they don't count academically. So how does that work at scale? Please tell me.
That works together with post-publication peer review, PubMed comments, PubPeer.
So no more journals.
Essentially, I think journals can curate afterwards. We can use Science Open to create collections. There will be a role for editors and journals to corral scientists to do the peer review, right? Because just because you've put out the preprint, it doesn't mean that scientists are now flocking to writing reviews for you. So there'll still be a role for publishers, but it's a very soft but Trojan horse way where you put out preprints, but eventually when enough people are doing it, it will undermine the journal as it exists today.
I do have to point out though that a preprint doesn't necessarily, isn't the only thing that you can put on a preprint server. There, preprint usually means before peer review, but I actually really dug into this recently. And many of the publishers, that members of the STM Association came out with this joint statement that said, actually, they're okay with not just preprints, but the post-peer review version, the unpublished version. Right, but the post-peer review version, they're actually okay with sharing in a lot of cases as well, which is a big difference.
Another data point for you is that we did a study of this in the physics community, which has had 100% preprint coverage for a long time now, and they haven't given up their journals, and I still have to pay more than almost any other discipline to subscribe to them. So can you explain to me why that's happening?
So in physics we have archive, but if there was no archive, because it's only a subset of stuff that's in archive, it hasn't made a difference for the journal. Well, my answer is, I think it has to be, this is why I said peer review, opening peer review and post-publication peer review is so important. I think it's coupled together with that, right? That will make all of the difference. It's not just, we now have a website where we can put a PDF. All right. And I think we're out of time.
So, well, thanks everyone for attending. I hope you've all enjoyed the event and found this useful. Please join us outside. We have plenty of food and refreshments for everybody. So hope to see you out there. Thank you.